Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Kishore Mabubani. I'm the Dean of the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy, and it gives me great pleasure to welcome you to this public lecture by Dato Sri Nazir Razak on politics and business in ASEAN. I think some of you have been here before, so you know that I only make 3 points when I introduce the speaker. My first point will be about ASEAN. My second point will be about Malaysia and Singapore, and the third point will be about our speaker, Dato Sri Nazir Razak. And here I can tell you that I'm really very happy to host this lecture today, even though, by the way, I arrived from Istanbul at 2:45 p.m. this afternoon. So if I fall asleep on the stage, it's not because of the speaker, it's because of the jet lag. But I'm very happy that I could make it in time for this lecture because both Dato Sri Nazir and I frankly share a common passion for ASEAN. In fact, I was telling Dato Sri that when I was in Istanbul, I did actually speak about ASEAN and describe ASEAN as a great undiscovered modern miracle that the rest of the world has completely underestimated. And here, so in that regard, to come back to Singapore and then to meet a fellow advocate of ASEAN here, it's a wonderful opportunity. And the timing of this lecture honestly couldn't be a better time, because ASEAN is going to make some very important decisions in the next 2-3 years. As you know, we are supposed to set up the ASEAN Economic Community by 2015. And as you know, unfortunately, there's already been some backsliding. It was supposed to be originally on 1st January 2015. They moved it back to 31st December 2015. I hope they don't move it back further. But if it's going to happen, one reason why it will happen is if the business community supports it also very strongly. And in this regard, I can tell you that Dato Sri Nazir plays a very important role. I think he's chairman of the ASEAN Business Club, and in this regard has played a very critical role in rallying the business communities to support ASEAN. And so I'm sure that we will learn a lot from him. And it is also, by the way, very fortunate that Malaysia will be the chair of ASEAN in 2015, so it will be Malaysia's job to, in a sense, complete the marathon and to ensure that we succeed in establishing this ASEAN economic community. The second point I was going to make is about Malaysia and Singapore. And I mean, I'm not giving you away any big secret if I say that traditionally we've had a neurotic relationship for a while. I always explain this neurotic relationship by saying, you know, we got married for 2 years, then we got divorced and continue to live in the same house, you know. So it's understandable. But the really good news is that I think we have finally overcome this neurosis, and under the two current prime ministers, and I'm sure you all know that the current prime minister is a brother of Dato Sri Nazir, and our current prime minister, Mr. Lee Hsien Loong, relations between Malaysia and Singapore have never been better. And in fact, with the concrete projects or cooperation that have been launched, is quite remarkable what is happening within the two countries. And symbolically also, it's in that sense very good that we've had Dato Sri Nazir Razak speaking at our school. And we were discussing just before he came here, I said, if I'm not mistaken, you're the most high-level Malaysian figure to speak at our school, and we're very grateful that you've come here, Nazir. Now, my final point is to just briefly say a word about the speaker, because I know you want to hear from him. I guess the most important point for you to note about him is that he comes from a family of prime ministers. His father was the second prime minister of Malaysia. His brother is the current prime minister of Malaysia. He could have easily had a career in politics, but he chose a much more difficult career, which is to go into banking. And having done so, it's actually remarkable how successful the bank has been. It has won a tremendous number of awards from many places. And he he's also, Dato Sri Nazir himself has won many awards. Finance Asia magazine named him one of the 50 most influential figures of the last decade in 2006. And he was the youngest recipient of Finance Asia's Lifetime Achievement Award in 2009. He was also named Best Top Executive in Malaysia by Asia Money in 2009-2010, Best CEO Malaysia by Finance Asia. I can carry on, that's a long list, so I won't read the whole long list, but it's quite remarkable how successful CIMB has been. And at the same time, while he's been busy as a chief executive officer, he's also been very interested in the academic environment. In fact, if I'm not mistaken, he's the only CEO to have actually taken a sabbatical in Oxford University and spent 9 months there while commuting within Singapore and running a bank. And that's quite a remarkable achievement. It shows his commitment to scholarship and to learning. And for that reason, he's a particularly appropriate speaker for us today. So with that, I'll turn the floor over to Dato Sri Nazir. Thank you once again for speaking at our school.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you, Kishore, for that great introduction. I agreed to speak here, I think like 2 years ago when Kishore was presenting at the CIMB conference in KL, and that was part of the deal. He would come if I would come back. I wasn't quite sure what I set myself up for, but he told me it was a good turnout, so I said they're probably all CIMB staff. But you know, thank you for the warm welcome, and thank you for the interest in my talk here. Let me also just acknowledge the presence of Professor Wang Gangwu. Thank you, Professor. Professor and I actually got our honorary doctorate. Honorary is the only doctorate I'll ever get. But we got it together about 6 months or so ago. Until today, I'm not sure whether I'm more proud of the doctorate or actually standing next to you, sir. Yeah. But you know, as I was thinking about what I should say, and it's quite daunting because I give speeches. I don't give lectures. The only lectures I give are to my staff. Yeah, and so I thought I'd better think about something interesting to share with you. So it's not going to be a sales pitch about ASEAN. I thought I'd talk about really not so much politics and business, but politics versus business. When I went to school or university, you know, we learned that politics and economics are always inextricably linked, they always say. But when I came back home here, operating in ASEAN, what I find that is that politics always overwhelms economics. And to businesses, the ability to understand and navigate politics is an essential trait. And why is this particularly so in ASEAN? Well, probably for four reasons. One is that when we talk about this great melting pot of diversity in race, religion, and culture that is ASEAN, we are actually also in the same breath, actually implying that there is great intensity of politics whenever we bring that diversity to bear within and across national boundaries. Second, most of our political systems remain in that difficult transition period from one party, and in some cases one person dominance, to something else. And so the risk of unprecedented political change frequently arises as you conduct your business. And thirdly, all ASEAN countries feature a very heavy presence of government in the economy and business for very legitimate reasons, you know, to accelerate and also to better manage development as a whole. It is, you know, I find it hard to find a material business in this region that doesn't come across government, you know, from the basic licensing permits to rules, regulations, government as the customer, government as the shareholder, and government company as the competitor. And, you know, even when they set rules of the game, they always make it blur enough so that power is actually still with the politician and with the bureaucrat. And I remember a senior civil servant who I went to see once. I actually went to see him to complain that, you know, the rules are ambiguous. And he pretty much confirmed that it was designed that way. Yeah. He said, why are you so surprised? You know, we do it all the time. So that, you know, in the end of the day, you have to ultimately seek our consent and all the implications of seeking that consent. And the fourth reason is that, of course, there is this politics between the ASEAN countries as we go towards AEC 2015, especially. And to me, today, the greatest threat to AEC is, of course, economic nationalism. So the long and the short of it, to thrive, businesses cannot ignore politics. They have to understand it country by country here in ASEAN, and then for the region as a whole. And then businesses must set guiding principles of how you want to operate, and then the tactics, and embed these in your business strategies. So, ladies and gentlemen, let's start with this whole element of diversity. My home country, Malaysia, is the one that always comes to mind when it comes to ethnic politics. Our political parties are mainly, of course, race-based, and we have a affirmative action program to rebalance wealth in favor of Bumiputras or indigenous people, and this is built into economic policy. And sadly, over recent years, I would say that Malaysians have probably strengthened their affiliation with their ethnic group more than they have with their country. So businesses in Malaysia have to take into consideration government policies on race. In some activities, licenses are subject to quotas. For instance, if you're a stockbroker and you can't hire enough Bumiputra remisiers, you cannot grow your number of remisiers. Government tenders have Bumiputra ownership rules, and there is pressure to ensure that there are enough Bumiputras in various key rungs of management and the boards. So, you know, when you run a business, if you want to make personnel decisions based purely on merit, you can't. And that, as a manager, brings about some very, very tough, specific situations. I'm not opposed to the idea of government intervention in the economy to create better distribution of wealth between groups of people to maintain political stability in particular. But race-based affirmative action is difficult to implement effectively, even harder to undo, and has massive side effects that can undermine what the government is trying to achieve in the first place. And if you look at, and this I refer to things like competitive zeal of Bumiputras today as a result of many years of the new economic policy. Tun Mahathir has spoken about this. And of course, intra-race class tensions as well also can arise. At my company, our approach to managing this challenge is instead to focus on diversity as a huge source of strength. So when we build teams in the company, we always encourage managers to have diversity in gender, in race, in age, in background, so that teams are strong, they get different views, different thinking, and a wider range of capabilities. So when the composition of managers is heavily skewed in any way, viz. Gender or race, then we ask the question and management does intervene. So if you look at gender, we have a rough rule of thumb. On a senior team, if you don't have at least a quarter, some of you will say 50%, but at least a quarter females, then probably something is wrong. We have to look at it. In the case of Bumiputras, if you don't have at least 30% Bumiputras in the group, when they make up two-thirds of the population, something is probably wrong, and we may want to intervene. And the important thing is that when we intervene, we try to do it in a way that doesn't make any individual feel penalized. So sometimes you have to intervene gradually or talk about the supply of younger generation rather than dealing with the problem immediately. Because if you go against the basic tenet of meritocracy so directly to individual, it's very, very demoralizing. So then when you take this to from a national standpoint, I have openly advocated a review of the new economic policy in Malaysia to make it more relevant for today's marketplace and today's Malaysians. I think that bringing diversity to the fore, together with what Prime Minister Najib has talked about in the conceptual new economic model for Malaysia, which is a needs-based affirmative action, put these together, I think this could be foundations of a much better way ahead for Malaysia. If nothing else, the terminologies we use are far, far less polarizing than today's very overt one-race-based preference policy. And of course, it's not just Malaysia that businesses have to be conscious about diversity and balancing. For instance, you know, today, ethnic tensions in Myanmar, you know, they're sort of maybe not pouring, but dripping cold water on this euphoria about the reopening of Myanmar. And in Indonesia, for instance, at CIMB, we have had to intervene to manage, in this case, the balance of our senior management between expatriates, between locals, and in the makeup of the religious beliefs of the senior management, just to maintain, just to ensure a sensible balance between all this. And in short, you know, in my view, wherever you want to do business in ASEAN, be extra sensitive to diversity. It's not easy to manage, but it's very powerful when you can leverage it. And after all, it is diversity that makes ASEAN such a wonderful place to be. Now, ladies and gentlemen, in all ASEAN countries, we are witnessing political transition in broadly the same direction, towards multi-party systems, stronger institutional checks and balances, and so on. But each doing so in their own unique way and pace. Most recently, Cambodia, for instance, we at CIMB actually had to make check on the cash balances at all our branches when we heard the election results, which, you know, of course, saw the ruling party's dominance diminish sharply. And even here in Singapore, I think the PAP doesn't take its re-election for granted anymore. So when you're doing business and faced with this political contest, for instance, and the safest approach is to steer clear of being deemed friendly to any political party or political figure. But that's easier said than done, yeah, because the government, as I said, is ubiquitous. And of course, and this is especially a problem when you're a significant business as CIMB is. So how does CIMB go about it? In Malaysia, CIMB's approach is what I describe as be close, but not too close. And it is literally as awkward as it sounds. Yeah. And fortunately, we have managed to continue to thrive as an investment bank and a banking group since the late 1980s. And you know, some will point out that actually Malaysia's never had a change of government. But actually, when you look closer, we've had significant political transition. You remember, in the early 1990s, we saw this optically smooth transition of the Ministry of Finance from Tun Daim Zainuddin to Anwar Ibrahim. But the whole corporate sector was rocked with the sort of emergence of two camps, the Anwar camp and the Daim camp. And then, of course, came the Asian financial crisis. Anwar was dismissed as finance minister, and there was this wholesale removal of his inner circle of advisors and businessmen. And you know, when you look at the Mahathir Badawi transition and the Badawi Najib transition, they were pretty well orchestrated, but they still triggered quite significant upheavals in the influences and the business men around the leaders. So, you know, we've survived this, and the way we go about it is, you know, close but not too close to me means being conscious of having a good relationship with the powers that be, but not to be seen to milk it, and self-regulating the influence you are perceived to have. Yeah, it is awkward and it's difficult to get right. But let me just say, it's certainly worth it because I have seen at first hand how people got too close, as it were. They have such a wonderful time when their master is in power, and then when there's a change of leadership, they fall, and in social terms, very, very brutally. Yeah. So my view, one has to be very careful about how you handle politicians, because you know they always draw you very, very close. They want you your loyalty, and they'll draw you in, and then they'll make you feel good, and then you have this sense that I'm in the inner circle, and then after a while you start being too influential and building up your enemy base, and then when your master falls, it's a nasty, nasty experience. Yeah, of course today, now that Kishore's declared I have a family relationship, I'm not sure whether I'll be able to protect CIMB again, but time will tell. Yeah. Now, let me just also, related to that, add this, that integrity is a very important principle to imbue in any business organization. Now, quite apart from the morality of it, corrupting is a dangerous game, and when mixed with our dynamic political environment, you know, it's toxic. You know, the clampdown in corruption today in Indonesia takes me back to the early 2000s when we first invested in Indonesia. In 2001 or so, we wanted to buy a bank called Bank Niaga, and that was the early days post-Asian financial crisis, and we were the first bank to approach IBRA. And everyone I met told me that, you know, there's no way you're going to get this asset unless, you know, you grease, however you describe it. Yeah, I remember this guy, and it was incredible. He actually saw me. He said, "Nazir, the problem with this country is this: everyone is corrupt." This is 2001, and he said this: "The problem with this country is everyone is corrupt." And by the way, I heard you want to buy a bank. If you give me some money, I can help you. It was surreal. It was surreal. And, you know, we didn't. We stuck to our principles. We were still successful. And, you know, today, if I think about it, if we had, you know, done something naughty, can you imagine until today, I still have sleepless nights, because you never know when those files will be opened. Yeah, so, you know, I would advise anyone doing business in ASEAN, you hear a lot of noise about having to do this or having to do these funny things, but, you know, particularly as foreigners, it ain't worth it. Yeah. Now, my next point is this whole economics textbook saying that the government has no business of being in business. And, you know, of course, today's consensus is it does, for many reasons, for lack of capital, for you know, various strategic reasons, and so on and so forth. But when you look around ASEAN, I always ask, does the government really need to be in so many activities and own so many businesses? Yeah. And, you know, there are, to me, the key is for the government to be in areas that it needs to be. Do not crowd out the private sector. And, you know, the government has unfair advantages and it does create market failures. In the Malaysian context, it worries me at how much property projects the government is undertaking, for instance, because banks, basically, if the government is a developer, say, hey, safe to lend to the government, because ultimately the company, the borrower won't fail, it's owned by the government. That is market failure. And today, you know, my position is that unless the government cuts back on the planned supply of office space, Malaysia will scale, will see a glut in offices in not too distant future. So again, that's an example of market failure. And you know, when you're competing with GLCs, sometimes you wonder why they have to be there. And fine, if sometimes they really have to be there, the key thing is how they govern. You look at Tony at Air Asia, he's screaming every day about competing with MAS and competing and having the government own the airports as well. And in this case, you know, it's a good example of, fine, if the government wants to be own the airline and the airport, the important thing is there should be a regulator, and in this case an aviation regulator, to ensure that the government, when its business, plays by the rules as well. Now, ladies and gentlemen, as Kishore mentioned just now, I am a very strong advocate of ASEAN economic integration. You know, my firm operates with this tagline, ASEAN for you, which means a lot of things, but at the very least, it also means that anything goes wrong with ASEAN, it actually affects our brand. Yeah, so, you know, that gives me the right to also be very critical of ASEAN. You know, AAC is a great idea. Much has been achieved by since 2007 when our leaders embraced the notion of integration. However, when you look, when you read the ASEAN 2012 scorecard of integration, it claims that 67.5% of the targets of the blueprint has been met, and that the ASEAN six countries had were already a free trade area. All this is but a gloss over reality. Yeah, you know, there are substantial exclusions to free trade even amongst the big ASEAN countries. They've got this exclusion system, temporary exclusion, sensitive, highly sensitive, and so on and so forth. So many goods are actually not part of this. And then if you look at non-trade barriers, they have, you know, these plans and these deadlines, but actually the blueprint doesn't even define what a non-trade barrier is. It is ambiguous. And, you know, there are many para-tariff measures everywhere. So when you look at it, you know, I still think the very construct and ethos of ASEAN, you know, perpetuates things like non-tariff barriers. And, you know, we sing about the virtues of the ASEAN way, but this informal, non-binding, consensus-seeking approach does not give ASEAN, the ASEAN Secretariat, the clout to push through regional economic integration. And relatedly, as we get closer and closer, I think the reality will set in that, look, out of integration, AEC, there will be a lot of winners and losers. You know, national monopolies will lose and so on and so forth. And there will be pushbacks. And when these pushbacks come, I'm not sure whether the governments will be able to withstand it. Already, you know, if you look at it, just a couple of years, you know, the most urbane Indonesian minister threatened BlackBerry RIM because they wanted to set up a plant in Penang, and yet their biggest customer base was in Indonesia. He basically said, if you know, in riding on ASEAN, and he said, if you do that, we will slap a specific tariff on BlackBerries. Yeah, and of course, I was just joking with Kishore just now. We had a seminar recently where Kishore was a moderator, and we had key business leaders, and the business leader from Indonesia was egged on by Kishore, and he finally burst out and admitted that, you know, he doesn't want AEC. Yeah, he doesn't want to share the profits he's making in Indonesia with foreigners. Yeah, this is on stage, and only Kishore can bring this out of the people. But it was surreal again. And you know, even 2 years before AEC, ASEAN, this ASEAN common identity is not really there. You know, we have not really found anything extra by being called ASEAN. In every country, the regulations define either you're a local or you're a foreigner. Yeah, there's nothing in between. ASEAN doesn't mean anything from the regulatory front. And this is 2 years before. And you know, we've invested in Indonesia, Thailand. We sing about being ASEAN and so on and so forth. But you know, I am concerned. And you know, if you look at yesterday's MOU between the Securities Commissions on collective investment schemes, it's noticeable there's only 3 countries out of 10 that actually signed it, even 2 years before AEC. And this neighborhood relationship, also neighboring relationships, is difficult because you know, we're also competitive, and we start, you know, CIMB always goes around and talks about being ASEAN. Wherever it goes, nobody believes us. They say, you're Malaysian, I don't care what you say. And I always ask this question, you know, to Singaporeans, Indonesians, Thais, which four-letter bank would you prefer to be successful, HSBC or CIMB? Yeah, I'm sure most of you say HSBC, yeah. Except those with CIMB accounts. You know, my message here is that concern about AEC, we must have an honest assessment of it, help businesses prepare for a realistic 2015, because I worry about disappointment, I worry about backpedaling, because backpedaling could then impact the economic integration as a whole over the long term. And my advice to businesses today, people are excited about ASEAN as a single production base and so on, is to be very mindful that it's going to be a very bumpy political ride over the next few years. Now, ladies and gentlemen, let me share a little bit about the art of navigating politics. To me, it's about continuously assessing the environment and whether it can facilitate or hinder what you want to do. There isn't a solution for all environments. And let me share with you three mergers and acquisition examples that CIMB has been involved in. The first one was in 2005 when CIMB bought this bank called Southern Bank. It was a hostile takeover. And I remember then it was painful because the media was really against it. They particularly the Chinese media, saying a Malay-controlled bank cannot take over a Chinese-controlled bank. Yeah, you know, those of you not familiar in Malaysia, basically, in Malaysia, when you have any problems, just blame it on race. Yeah. So I had the Chinese papers writing editorials to me to basically say, you know, you just can't do this and so on and so forth. So it's very painful. But at that point in time, I was confident all the way that we would do it because we had a prime minister who had a very strong majority and basically said to us, whatever it is, this deal should be decided by market forces. I will not intervene. Yeah, so as brutal as it was a public fight between us and Southern Bank, the deal went through because we had a strong center. In sharp contrast stands the bitter experience of the Malaysia Airlines and AirAsia share swap in 2011. There was a cross-holding between AirAsia's shareholders called Tune and Khazanah. This deal made absolute economic sense for both MAS and AirAsia. I think they would really have given the combined Malaysia Airlines and AirAsia would have seriously worried Singapore Airlines, you know. We misjudged the politics around the deal. Internally, MAS staff didn't like the idea of being controlled by AirAsia staff, AirAsia people. and there was noise. Consumer was a little bit started to worry about monopoly or collusion, even though we announced a setup of we said we would set up an independent regulator, but because we didn't do it in time, the consumer got agitated. And of course, within the political circles, there was a lot of opposition to the idea of ceding control of the national airline to Tony Fernandez for one reason or other, maybe because he's just loud, but for one reason or another. And of course, these days the center is not politically secure, so it was, you know, in the end of the day, unable to take a strong position on ensuring that this merger went through. So the deal was heavily attacked. Government decided it had to be unwound, and the two went its own way. But today, even today, I look back and I wonder whether our failure to anticipate and manage the politics has really deprived the company, the country, of a truly globally competitive airline. The third one is again back to economic nationalism in Indonesia. You know, in 2002, I remember we were welcomed to investing in Indonesia. Just an aside, when we bid for Bank Niaga, I remember them telling us it's a very competitive. This is 2001-2002, very competitive transaction. Put a good price. So I put a good price in there, and then a few days later they called up and said, "Congratulations, you're successful." I said, "You're on the shortlist." I said, "Great, who else is on the shortlist?" "Nobody, just you." So that was the Indonesian situation then, you know. And after we bought Bank Niaga, our share price went down 25%. But then, fast forward 10 years, we suddenly get told by the central bank, "We don't really like foreigners, so perhaps we're going to ask you to sell out." You know, and that was traumatic, but of course that didn't happen. But the point is, in today's environment, economic nationalism in Indonesia is strong, and it's something that one has to navigate. So for us, you know, the M&A, another M&A in Indonesia is not on the table. I don't think it's going to be possible. I don't need to call Piyush Gupta to know that. Yeah, and so what we're focused on is really instead something else, which is to adjust our regional strategy to limit the extent that we integrate our Indonesian business to our regional operations, because they want our Indonesian operations to be kept separate. So we're actually moving from the our dream of one ASEAN bank to a multi-local bank instead. Yeah. So again, when you look at this, my message is in ASEAN, long-term strategies must always be revisited to cater for changing political dynamics. And in the case of our ASEAN ambitions, I think what I just described is entirely consistent with the concerns I expressed earlier about the political realities of ASEAN or ASEAN integration as we get closer and closer. So in conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, we are, you know, doing business in arguably the best geographic location for this century that will see Asia rise again. And, you know, this has been wonderful, frequently and so eloquently written by Kishore. He always talks about the fabulous upside of ASEAN Asian century. That's why I didn't want to repeat it today. But instead, I hope I have, you know, in my way, no doubt, much, much less eloquently than Kishore does, but from the ground level, shown that a key challenge for all of us is the politics surrounding doing business in ASEAN. And, you know, perhaps though, if we collectively better manage and leverage diversity, mitigate some of the side effects of government presence in our economies, and strengthen our commitment and push for regional integration, ASEAN can actually scale even greater heights than Kishore and others have us dreaming of. Thank you for your attention.
I must confess to all of you that You were remarkably candid. It's a level of candor I didn't expect, so I'm a bit shell-shocked.
Is it because you've been in Singapore too long?
That's right. Now, I would love to see a banker in Singapore discuss the politics of Singapore as frankly as he discussed the politics of Malaysia. That would be the day, you know. But I'm going to build on your point about politics and its impact on ASEAN. Because, I mean, clearly the AEC is coming up in 2015. And the good news is that there will be a lot of political pressure on the governments to deliver on their commitments. But at the same time, as you know, there are forces holding them back. So at the end of the day, if you had to analyze the forces that are pushing for the AEC and the forces that are sort of holding it back, is it more a case of the governments pushing and the business holding back, or more a case of the business pushing and governments holding back? Overall, what's your sense? Because it could vary from country to country too. So what's your analysis of AEC?
I think the problem is AEC is not much without Indonesia.
No.
And at the moment, I'm concerned about Indonesia's real commitment to AEC. I think if you reflect back when they were, Indonesia was chairman of ASEAN that year also, you know, that wasn't, they didn't really, you know, SBY didn't really grab the bull by the horns. And we never really felt, you know, if you, we were talking earlier about the old Suharto days, when Suharto was really a real force in ASEAN 1.0, which is all about the political unity of ASEAN. But today, there's a serious lack of leadership. So if you look at the top businesses in Indonesia, I think they're all quite hesitant, as I mentioned. Frankly, the ties have suddenly stepped up, right? And they're quite excited about ASEAN. Originally, they were worried because of language limitations, but I think now they've grown in confidence. The Malaysians and Singaporeans, of course, and of course the
Malaysians and Singapore have always been in support.
Have always been in support, but you know, I don't think there's and then we have to give some special exemptions for the north and northern countries. So the key to it is really, you know, Indonesia. And we really need stronger buy-in and support from the Indonesian corporates and the Indonesian government.
Because the question is then, how do we persuade them that, you know, in theory, Indonesia's got the largest market within ASEAN and therefore they want to protect it, but in practice, their real competitors are China and India, and their market is so much smaller than China and India. And realistically, if you do any kind of long-term economic projection, the economic case will show that Indonesia is actually better off pushing for the ASEAN economic community, because that will create a stronger Indonesian economy and make it more competitive. The economic case is very clear, but it's very difficult to sell it politically within Indonesia.
Yeah, and unfortunately, Indonesia is so attractive that its companies also are reluctant to go overseas. I think if it did more business in Malaysia and Singapore, then the sense of confidence and linkages to the benefits of more integration would be, you know, would be more obvious to them. I mean, if you look at, you know, the Mandiris and the BCAs, they should be expanding into Singapore and Malaysia and so on.
Great. Okay, the floor is open. We have about 30 minutes of Q&A. Anybody wants to ask the first question? Any hands? This is shocking. Okay. I mean, the first question is always very difficult. Please, if you don't mind. Yeah. Identify yourself and...
Yes. Good evening, sir. So my name is Lin. I'm from Myanmar. I'm studying here for MPP program. You mentioned about Myanmar, so I'm very interested about that. Myanmar has opened since 2 years ago. So what is your plans for your company in Myanmar?
You know, we have been with a rep office in Myanmar since 1995.
From 1995 until last year, every year I would write to the Human Rights Commission and explain to them why I'm in Myanmar. My worry today is the Myanmar government forgets that we were there through thick and thin, and then licenses get given to the other four-letter banks and so on and so forth. So I hope Myanmar remembers ASEAN for what ASEAN has done for it. But you know, we of course visited Myanmar. I'm a little bit concerned that there isn't a very clear plan as yet. And I think, you know, probably quite rightly that Dorsu is kind of tempering the excitement and wants to do this more methodically. So, you know, I don't think we're in a rush to go in. We would like the opportunity to participate when Myanmar is ready. But, you know, I think the time will come, but I think it's probably more gradual than people are making out today. And I think, you know, it would be good if someone really sat down and kind of ticked all the boxes in terms of what needs to be done. Yeah, in terms of, you know, legal frameworks and so on and so forth. Yeah.
Can I just add a note on that? About 10 days ago, Dr. Aung San Suu Kyi came to our school, and on a Sunday, about 11 o'clock in the morning, she had a private discussion with our faculty. And it became very clear in that private discussion that she felt, and I hope let me make sure I choose my words very, very carefully. I think her message was that ASEAN should treat her more seriously and ASEAN should talk more to Aung San Suu Kyi. And I think that was one of the messages she was also trying to put across when she was at our school, because she felt that the ASEAN countries dealing with the government and not enough with her. But that's, of course, the difficulty there is that as a foreign government, you can't interfere too much within the politics within Myanmar. So, next question, please. Can you identify yourself again, please?
Hi, I'm Ririn. I'm the MPP junior here. I'm from Indonesia.
Indonesia, right?
Indonesia, yeah. I think the information about the Indonesian companies who are reluctant to expand in Asia, I think it's kind of not completely wrong, but I don't think it's... I don't think the Indonesian companies is reluctant to expand in ASEAN, because what Mandiri did last year, like for several years ago, they are trying to enter the Singapore market, but the thing is they can't. I don't know what is the problem in that case, but they can't. And then the other thing is there are many state-owned companies entering Myanmar right now. They are pursuing the projects and anything. So I'm not agree with your statement that the Indonesian companies is reluctant to expand their market in ASEAN. So the thing is, what is your suggestion for the whole ASEAN? I mean, like for to support Indonesian companies to expand their market to ASEAN, especially Singapore. Thank you.
No, I think we have to be a little bit careful here, because. When you talk about, I don't really talking about my competitors so directly here, but you know, if you talk about that situation about reciprocity, it's a little. You know, I have a bit of a beef with this, because the concept that there isn't reciprocity is quite difficult, because when we went to Indonesia, we paid big premiums, right, to enter. And as I described to you, when we were the first foreigner to come into Indonesia, et cetera, but we paid a premium. In the case of Mandiri or other Indonesian banks wanting to come to Malaysia or Singapore, as it were, it's really a question of getting a free new license, right? And in that context, you have to abide by the same licensing rules as everybody has. And where the problem Mandiri had is not so much getting the license, it's about its wish or to get exemptions from the rules that actually applies to everybody. Yeah. So Malaysia has given Mandiri a license, but Mandiri doesn't like the conditions, which is actually the same conditions that we give to everybody. Yeah, and you know, when you talk to Mandiri, they've also expressed some concern about the low margins that banks earn in Malaysia. Yeah, well, you know, that's what you get when you expand. And really, you know, I honestly think one of the problems is it's your country is just heaving in terms of economic activity. Profit margins are really, really fat. So that's why the you know, the question is why all the complications of doing business overseas. And don't forget, I felt this in the early 1990s, you know, when Malaysia was doing so well and so on and so forth. Why bother looking overseas, right? And it's when you get saturation, compressing the margins there, and you get this push. Yeah. So, you know, what we would like to do is encourage and do what we can to facilitate more Indonesians to operate overseas. Yeah, and in that regard, you know, it's about, you know, I've been there, marketing and so on and so forth. But it's quite tough because, again, when I show the ROIs of investments in Malaysia, it's lousy to them. And then when I show ROIs of investment in Singapore, it's lousier to them.
I think he's becoming too candid. Huh?
You told me no media.
Okay, next question. Then after that, I'll come to you. Yes, Reese, go ahead.
Hi.
You're next. Yeah.
Yeah, my name is Hong. I work for a fund management firm. And in fact, I think your four-letter banks have done a great job. So we actually we are a client of two four-letter banks. Yeah. Hmm. Yeah, so comparable services, yeah, in ASEAN, at least in ASEAN, yeah. My question is, you know, we hear about your disappointment about how is it progress on this AEC 2015. Now, we also know that next week, Obama, despite the shutdown in the, at the home states, he's going to be in Indonesia, yeah. So
are you sure?
Well,
one thing about
that's what the paper tell us. Yeah, so my question is, you know, we're gonna have this TPP as well that's coming, yeah. Do you have hope on that will achieve the same purpose, or you know, given that now ASEAN and East Asia has become such a priority area for US, and that would essentially achieve the same purpose as what or the ASEAN country original set off to achieve, yeah.
No, I mean this TPP. I never know, is it TPP or TTP?
No, TPP, Trans-Pacific Partnership.
TPP.
And the Transatlantic is TTIP, TTIP. Because you know why, the reason for that, and just in case you do not know this, it should actually be called the Transatlantic Free Trade Agreement, TAFTA. But after NAFTA became politically toxic in America, they couldn't have TAFTA rhyming with NAFTA. So they call it TTIP. There's politics behind acronyms, by the way. So it's TPP.
I'm not sure whether this there will be the sign-offs that people think there will be. As you know, ASEAN, there's only Malaysia, Brunei, and Singapore.
Thailand too, isn't it?
No.
TTIP, no?
No.
TPP? No. Only Malaysia, Singapore.
And Brunei.
Vietnam.
So, Indonesia's not there, Thailand's not there. And frankly, Malaysia is having serious difficulties with, you know, the drafts and conditions, as it were. But, you know, to the extent that it opens up markets, etc., etc., I think, you know, why not? ASEAN already has its FTA with China and so on and so forth. But I think it still doesn't detract from what is most important, which is the full economic integration of ASEAN itself. Yeah, I think, you know, we have to create this one block. We have to be a large economy in a future that's going to be about large economies. Now, this is what, you know, when you talk about Indonesia, etc., some of the hesitation, people forget that Indonesia, 200 million people, is small in the context of the global investors and the competitive landscape of nations, if you like. It is imperative that we become 600.
Mm. Gentlemen over here, please. Yes.
Dr. Goh Kim Seng, a student. you know, let me just share experience with you, Dato Sri, on Myanmar, because I happen to have been there for over 20 years now. I appreciate your problem, you know, of having been there for so long and not being able to establish yourself vis-a-vis the four-lettered banks. I think, first of all, if I might say with respect to the government of Myanmar, is that you need to be a bit of a Freud yourself.
You need to be a bit of what?
Freud. Yeah. Get some people on the Freudian couch and you'll understand if you can get the government over their xenophobia, then you'll have no problems at all. I personally was rather surprised, you know, when I applied for a transfer of telephone here, right here in Singapore, first world, fourth wave technology, you know, it took me about a week. When I did foreign direct investments with the government of Myanmar, I did that within 3 days. And when I applied for a telephone in Myanmar, as a FDI, foreign direct investor, in a hotel project, in a development project, you know, I got everything through in 3 days without any form of bakshish, all right? So I think there, you've got to understand the modern history. Get them on the Freudian couch. And I didn't pay a dime either. And you find that things go quite smoothly. Four-lettered or three-lettered banks or five-lettered banks in material. Now, the other thing is on the question of ASEAN. I seem to recall that over Maastricht and the EU, the late Lady Thatcher said that these chaps were talking in sweet cuckoo land. And in the same context, I think it was the Italian Prime Minister many, many years ago when Italy was consolidated to a state, you know. He was talking about having formed Italy, do we have Italians? And so I often wonder that ASEAN is a great concept. And having formed ASEAN, do we have an ASEANese or ASEANer or whatever it is? So I'm sort of curious what your thoughts are on this matter.
Two questions, one about Freud and one about ASEANese. The one about Freud, I'm not sure.
You take the Freud.
Okay.
Well, the basic point is there's quite a lot of xenophobia, and if you can understand that, you know, you'll find you'll get your banks through in just like that.
Thank you. So that's a free consultancy advice from you.
You're sending the bill.
Yes, sir, you can see me.
No, I agree with this issue of the ASEAN identity. Because I think in the end of the day, we should have, you know, we should be Malaysian and from ASEAN, whatever you want to do it. And I've always said before, the problem is there doesn't seem to be anyone marketing ASEAN to ASEAN people.
Yeah.
You know, our leaders go off to their junkets and then they hold hands. I don't know why. Why do you guys do this? I mean, I hold hands with the Prime Minister. Holding hands with the Prime Minister of Thailand, I understand.
Watch out, you're going to be quoted on that.
And then after that, when they go home, they're just inundated with their, you know, daily work. And nobody talks about ASEAN. You know, I have asked that each country by this stage should actually have a minister of ASEAN whose sole purpose is to talk about ASEAN all the time. Yeah, to market ASEAN, to tell people be ready for AEC 2015 and that when why it's a good thing. And that why we should create this, create this identity that we are also from the ASEAN region. And then that's one suggestion. And I know, you know, I think Khun Korn has talked about the idea of ASEAN bidding for the World Cup together. I mean, these kind of things. But who does it? No, the ASEAN Secretariat, the budget is something like 15 million or something. Mm-hmm. It's a joke.
Tiny,
you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, and you know, I remember Surin always, the ASEAN SecGen, always telling me, he said, I'm SecGen of ASEAN, but I'm more secretary than general.
It's like the United Nations Secretary General also. He's more secretary than general too. But you know, you raised a very critical point about selling ASEAN to the ASEAN people. Because up to now, the ownership of ASEAN has been felt very much by the governments and to some extent by the elites, but the population at large actually doesn't have it. But one good decision that the ASEAN embassies made was that if you go to London, for example, you see that the Singapore High Commission has got a Singapore flag and the ASEAN flag following the EU. And that, to me, was a wonderful eye-opener. And that makes people more aware of the ASEAN flag. But we need to do more down there. I see two questions, one and to the gentleman in the yellow shirt after that. Can you make it quick because we are
sure.
running
Thank you very much, Dean. Well, Dato Sri, very good afternoon. My question here, I think that you convey in all sincerity the context of inconvenient truths, indecent proposal. Can I ask you for one thing that you avoid with regard to why DBS failure with regard to the attempt for the acquisition of the Indonesian bank? Can you check into it? And I mean, could you give us your perspective with regard to in that incidental matter? Thanks a lot.
You obviously asked him a very sensitive question. Next question. you answer that first, and then we'll take two more. Yeah.
Can I not answer it? No, honestly.
You can fairly say no comment because it's a very sensitive issue. But go ahead. It's up to you. Yeah.
I don't know.
Actually, he knows lah.
I honestly don't know.
But to be fair, it is very awkward, I think, for given his position to comment on something like that because there are very sensitive dynamics there.
But yeah. I was very supportive of it.
Yeah.
I wanted, you know.
You wanted DBS to win.
I wanted DBS to also have the regulatory problems I have.
I think they call it a poison chalice. Please.
My name is Mohit. My question is, first of all, I'd like to
identify yourself, please.
I'm Mohit from Expedia Transnational. It's a trading company in Singapore. Firstly, we are very delighted to meet a gentleman like you who has such a lot of experience in having business in almost every country of the ASEAN. And my question is, how do you find you're doing business in Singapore to vis-a-vis to rest of the ASEAN countries? And can Singapore learn from something about from rest of the ASEAN countries, or rest of the ASEAN countries can learn something from Singapore about doing business?
Another difficult question.
Well, I think, I think everyone needs to learn from each other. That's my basic fact. So when we set up businesses, say, CIMB starts in Malaysia, opens a business in Indonesia, my basic rule is that, look, we're all human beings, and we learn new things from each other. It's about sharing of knowledge. So for instance, when we went to Indonesia, we looked at the operation there and we had limitations in, say, the treasury business. But yet, my branches of the bank I bought in Indonesia had the best quality service that I had. So I literally moved treasury people from Malaysia to Singapore, moved branch staff from to Indonesia, and moved branch staff from Indonesia to Malaysia. So it's about that openness to be able to learn, and the humility to learn from whoever you can learn. Yeah. So far as Singapore is concerned, maybe.
Okay, you can say whatever you want to say. It's all right.
Maybe Singapore would be better if Singapore, has the humility to learn more. That's what I would say.
And my first question was what is the major difference you find in Singapore business environment and the rest of the ASEAN countries?
Well, Singapore is very predictable, you know. No, the regulatory frameworks, etc., etc., is very predictable, and it's actually a very, very easy place to operate. Yeah, but returns are very low. And so, you know, that's the trade-off. Yeah.
Okay, maybe last two questions. Let's take the three questions quickly then, if you don't mind. One, Teo Soon Ho, and then one over there. Quickly, come to the mics if you don't mind. Let's take all three questions, we've got to finish in 6:30. So.
Dato Sri, my name is T.H. Chien from Teng San from the private sector. I'm a Malaysian born. In Malaysia right now, things are very, very politicized between the racial, the Chinese and the Burmese. They are really not working together. Now, if winning Malaysia itself, you have this problem. Singapore companies, small and medium enterprise, a lot are Chinese-based. How can you talk about AEC when winning your side, you already have your own racial unhappiness? Maybe, can you elaborate on that?
Did you get the question? Yeah, okay.
Next question, I was really hoping I won't get.
Well, my question is also along the same lines. My name is Teo Soon Ho. I work for Capital Corporation. Your candor, Dato Sri, really provoked this question. It's been burning inside me for a long time. I too was born in Malaysia, and I've been observing Malaysia, you know, from the outside. And as you know, I'm non-Bumi, and I've been watching, you know, with, you know, great, anxiety, the deteriorating condition in Malaysia, the judiciary, the security or lack of, you know, and as was said, the race, you know, issues. I've seen many of my friends who are non-Bumis who actually want to come out of the country. So, you know, perhaps you could comment, you know, on the points that I've raised, since using the same candor that you have, you know, been displaying throughout this whole session.
I think we may have to put a limit to the candor somewhere.
Can I remind you, the Malaysian High Commissioner is here.
Okay.
Good evening. My name is Vivek. I work for a beverage company here in Singapore with extensive operations in ASEAN. My question is that ASEAN is a great place to be in. We have 6% growth of an average.
You're from a British company, right?
No, I work for Tiger Beer.
Tiger Beer, oh, okay.
Yeah. So we have presence.
It used to be a Singapore company.
Yes.
So go ahead, sorry.
We have growth, like very good GDP growth across almost all the ASEAN countries. But the recent tapering that we saw and the effect it had on the financial markets and currencies in some ASEAN countries left it pretty vulnerable. Just wanted your perspective from a banker's point of view. How do you see the outlook of the currencies here, the markets, and how vulnerable are we to such withdrawal of liquidity? Thank you.
Well, three difficult questions.
Take that one. No, I think in terms of the tapering, I think my view is simply this. I think in the end of the day, this day was coming, right? In fact, it hasn't come yet. Yeah, but tapering will come. And we have enjoyed this
easy
exceptional
money.
Period of easy money. Right. So those that actually thought this easy money was because they were so cool and so hot and so on and so forth, will pay the price. Those that actually said that, you know, hey, I'm just going to enjoy it, but I know that this is going to run out, are going to be quite safe. The good news is that I think about 2 months ago, there was a full sell down of all emerging markets. I think what's happening now is investors are really quite discerning in terms of differentiating between different emerging markets. And I think, you know, they are, say, distinguishing between India and Indonesia, right? And the key thing is, I think, with the amount of scrutiny that countries are being faced, it's very, very important that the governments get their financials right. And, you know, in the past few days, the numbers coming out of the deficit numbers coming out from Indonesia and Thailand has actually been very, very good. Yeah, so I think that at least for the near term, we're probably going to see a little bit of an upturn in the regional markets. For the long term, though, one needs to prepare for this eventuality of tapering off. Yeah. On the this polarization in Malaysia, I think what the best way to look at this is if you look at take us 5 years back, I think the government really sat down. I'm very careful when I use the term we. The government sat down and looked at the situation. Yeah. It talked about, very openly, if you look at the new economic model, talked openly about the brain drain, talked openly about the lack of investment since the Asian financial crisis, and came up with, if you look at the wording in the new economic model, a needs-based affirmative action, right? That's a very, very substantive move from the new economic policy, right? But it's still a concept, yeah? But it was articulated. Then the economic transformation program, the setting up of Talent Corp, they're designed to bring both of you back to work in Malaysia, for instance, right? So you can see that these problems are understood. And Prime Minister Najib launched the One Malaysia concept, right? Which is, a bit hairy-fairy, but you get the general gist of it, which is that we want to leverage on diversity, create a stronger sense of unity amongst Malaysians, and it is quite consistent with the sort of indication of a shift from, as I said, the race-based to the needs-based affirmative action. Unfortunately, we've just had a general election that didn't quite go so well, yeah, in these terms. And then we had September the 14th, when there was a reaffirmation of some of the initiatives, the old NEP initiatives. Yeah. So I am concerned with the direction of things today. What you've seen is the outcome, the consequences, I think, of a general election result that was showed how polarized the country is. And I'm not sure, I think it's still early days in terms of how Prime Minister Najib, what his full agenda for his second term is. It's still quite early days. I would look forward to him essentially reaffirming that he wants to implement the new economic model as is articulated, and the whole economic transformation as is being driven by Pemandu today. Because I think those plans are absolutely right. The problem is there's the real politic of trying to implement these changes, and the GE13 unfortunately has been quite a significant setback to the reform agenda. Yeah, I mean that's the honest truth of the way I look at the situation, and I hope that where he goes from here is to get back on that reform path, if you like. That is the hope, because I think that is the right way for Malaysia going forwards. And within that plan that he originally had, it addresses, it tries to address many of the concerns of ex-Malaysians, why Malaysians have decided to work overseas, and some of the other issues. You gotta live with hope. Yeah.
I think
we're going through a trying period.
I think you would all agree with me that I've chaired so many talks sitting here. I think you raised the level of candor at this stage to a new high. And I think that's a very good sign, frankly, for ASEAN. Because when I started working in ASEAN long, long time ago, and I was telling him, I think I met his father in 1971 when ASEAN launched the Zone of Peace, Freedom and Neutrality in Kuala Lumpur, and I was there. And at that time, when you spoke about ASEAN,
you had to be so careful about the sensitivities of each ASEAN country, and you internally absorbed things you could not say about this country or that country and so on and so forth. And clearly we've come a very long way in these 42 years, and you can see now we can talk about each other's strengths and weaknesses. And I think going forward, if we can have more of such candid discussions, I think ASEAN will become stronger as a process, and as we look ahead to the ASEAN economic community. Even though you came here and told us all the problems, I actually, surprisingly, after listening to your candor, now feeling even more optimistic about ASEAN. I mean, I'm on some drugs or something. But I do think that hopefully this will trigger a new kind of frank, open discussions about the strengths and weaknesses of ASEAN, and I have no doubt that your discussion has made a major contribution. And for that, we thank you very much for visiting us and for coming. And we hope you come back again.
The Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy.